morning, once more. Again, thank you for coming to that course. I would like to briefly describe the purpose which you may try to achieve attending that course. It may be that you are just a young researcher which is looking for an area to make your own investigation. Then what I will tell you about is a relatively attractive area, especially in the following respect. You know, there are a lot of branches of mathematics, different branches of mathematics. Many of them has a very long history and was developed for a long time. And if they are very reputable and very useful, but what happens? So if, as a young researcher, you will enter such a field, you will find out what you need to spend a lot of time learning what is already known, going through the hard techniques and the results. At the end, you will understand what all principal results are already obtained by someone else before. And what you may try to do is very hard problems, which was not solved by great minds in the previous 50 or 70 years. And we just left it to you. So, and this is really maybe for young people in challenging task. Young people are ambitious and they may want to attempt something which was not done by other people in previous generations. But on the other hand, if it's a difficult problem, so you may spend a lot of time and without any particular success. The area which I will telling you about is not so developed yet, and so there are quite a lot of results which still accessible and in the early stage. So it's not like an area where a lot of people work for a big period of time and solve everything which was possible to solve in reasonable amount of years. So if you are looking for your own research, for your area to start your research. So what I will tell you about is useful and you may consider it. Another direction or another aim, what you maybe already have your own area of research, you are studying certain problems. And then the course which I will tell you about may be just useful in giving additional dimension and providing additional techniques. So what we are speaking about has a lot of different applications. And so even continue to work in your own area, you still may find something interesting, useful, and maybe something which enrich and support your work in that particular direction. So whatever is your purpose, I will try to present material in a relatively accessible and simple way. I try to escape all technicalities and concentrate on the main ideas and provide you with something which shall be accessible for people with rather general background. However, please don't be shy if you don't understand something, if you would like to couple of word of explanation for some notion which you may be meeting first time. So ask immediately, don't delay it. So it will be good to have two-way communication on that opportunity. You know, in mathematics, it's very easy to get lost if you at the beginning just did not understand certain definition. Afterward, you may not get anything. So it will be good if we will really have a kind of dialogue during this lecture. So whenever you feel some explanation are necessary, please don't hesitate to ask about it. Let me briefly describe some historical and philosophical origin of that course. Already during introduction section, it was told what it's really for mathematics is important to have a connection with real world and connection to application. It will be good if mathematics will not be viewed just like a intellectual game, but something which is reflecting our environment. And in fact, the origin of mathematics is exactly like that. So mathematics appeared as a certain way to describe reality, In particular, in our course, we have the word geometry, which in Greek, as you know, mean measuring of land. So this is practical origin of that science. And afterwards, when people start to think not only about plane earth surface, they start to describe three-dimensional space. So it believed what geometry is certain science which describe the reality, so it describe the universe around us. It was for a very long time, and it maybe in 17th, 18th century, new types of geometry appeared. And for example, it was a great surprise to mathematicians in the that period. So you probably heard about the fifth postulate of Euclid. When it's told what whenever you have a straight line and you have a point, there is just exactly one straight line parallel passing that point. So it was for a long time a debate, either it's really a postulate or it can be a theorem. Suddenly, in 19th century, several people, almost simultaneously, Lobachevsky, Boyer, and Gauss, discovered what, in fact, we may construct the geometry which is violating that fifth postulate. And when, in addition to that, usual geometry, which people believed describing the real world, it was possible logically to construct other geometries which shall describe something. But what we are describing, we have just one world surrounding us. So if there is shall exist just one geometry which describe it. On top of it, in the same period, people developed, besides of Euclidean geometries, the affine and projective geometries and other types of geometries. And suddenly happened what there is huge possibilities to develop different theory. And somehow mathematicians and maybe philosophers became lost at this point. So they try to get an explanation how it's possible what mathematics, which believed to be a science describing the real world, suddenly start to have a lot of different faces. And it was several responses to that challenge. So people try to find several explanations. One of them was given by Riemann, and another was given by Felix Klein. So, and it was kind of two inaugurational lectures given by respective mathematicians. And Riemann suggested what we may consider geometry using the mathematical analysis, which by this time was very well developed. And in particular, it was suggested what we may infinitesimally describe the geometry for any given point. We are given some infinitesimal description, which look a little bit like Euclidean geometry, but that may vary from point to point. And that Euclidean type geometry around different points have different properties. And when passing from along the entire, what's called the Riemann manifold, there is a possibility to give a very general representation out of that infinitesimal type of description. So something which related to mathematical analysis, differential operators. In particular, the second order differential operators became very important, and it was realized what the distance in Riemannian geometry can be described as certain integral of the that metric which is given here by the Laplacian. So it's positively defined, so it's elliptic type second order differential equation, differential operator, and that produce a kind of Euclidean space which has varying the geometry from point to point. And if you start to think about mathematics as possibility to make additional assumptions and use mathematical analogy to produce a different area, so you may consider a similar expression where, for example, you may not have the elliptic operator, but rather you take hyperbolic one, wave equation, and then you may ask how to proceed with this type of geometry, and solution would be a connection between operators of the second order and first order operators, which is known as a factorization. So for example, the second order Laplacian can be factorized into two linear differential operators using the imaginary unit. So here, as you know, again, it may come from the simple fact what there is no we know a decomposition of the difference of square, so we may factorize into product A minus B A plus B, but we cannot do anything like that with elliptic expression, so we need to introduce imaginary unit for it. And operator which appears here as a factor, linear term, so just with one, is a celebrated Cauchy-Riemann operator which define the analytic functions on the complex plane. And that analytic functions on the complex plane has a lot of special properties. Again, at the moment, I am giving some introduction. Maybe I am speaking a bit fast, but we will come back to that type of analytical function theory in the second part of our course. So here is just a brief overview. So we are not start real mathematics yet. And when we have a wave equation, of course, you may simply use a factorization of this type. So you may factorize it in this way, but you may use certain hypercomplex unit which squared to one to put in this place as we have imaginary unit for the Laplacian. At this point, it may be not obvious why you need at all to introduce this type of imaginary unit, but hyperbolic imaginary unit J. But we will describe that in a little bit in details later in corresponding part of the course. And whenever we have already two possibilities, what I squared is equal to minus one and J squared equal to one, of course, it's natural to consider the third possibility when square produces zero, right? So I will denote such a unit by epsilon for a reason which we will discuss soon. And so we put a condition what epsilon square is equal to zero, although epsilon is not zero itself. So as J is not one or minus one here, it's just additional new object. So similarly, epsilon is not zero, but it's squared to zero. And then if you try to make an expression, what will be a factorization of this type with this epsilon, then using the simple algebra, you see what you have a square minus epsilon BA plus epsilon BA, so that will be canceled out, and then you have minus epsilon squared B, but epsilon squared is zero, so that term disappeared, so you have just a squared. So if you will think in term, yeah? Sorry?
A and B, where the lump came from, and the ground field.
Sorry, are you asking A, B are real numbers or what? Yes. A, B is just real numbers, it's just some basic algebra we are discussing at the moment. So the issue which come from a real simple algebra here, what having three type of equation, elliptic one, hyperbolic, when we may naturally try to consider a parabolic equation, but as you see, for parabolic equation, factorization with, say, parabolic unit epsilon squared equal to zero does not lead to something which we want. So this is a kind of a limiting approach if we introduce that hyper complex numbers and try to do something using them. And in particular, what we will discuss in our course, we will see how that third possibility, a parabolic one, can naturally appear out of the symmetry group SL2R. And that here we come to so-called Erlangen program. So this is a point of view which was attributed mainly to inaugurational lecture of Felix Klein at when he started a professor position at Erlangen University. So as he gave inaugurational lecture, and he proposed a way out of the problem which we discussed at the start. So we said what by the time, and 1872, were known several different types of geometry. Besides of Euclidean geometry, it was non-Euclidean geometry, spherical geometry, projective geometry, affine geometry. So how to make order in that collection of geometries. And Felix Klein said what really geometry is the theory of invariance under certain transitive group action. So for example, when we are studying Euclidean geometry, geometry of surrounding space, as we believed, so we are considering the transformation of the space which leave the invariance certain object. So when I move pen, so we know what physically the length of the pen is not changed. And if I rotate the pen, so the length again is not changed. So this is the group of Euclidean motions when we have rotations and we have shifts. And Euclidean geometry study just things like lengths and angles which are invariant under such transformation. If I add scaling, length is not preserved anymore. So, but I still may be considering certain angles by scaling, angles may be preserved. And when I may add additional transformation in such a way that angle between different line may be changed after this transformation, but still there is something invariant under such a transformation. And this is invariance can be, for example, a relation of incidence when we have a straight line and a point belonging to that line after shift, rotation, and scaling, and maybe some slant, other transformation, we have an image so of that line. It go to some other direction, and point will be some different direction. But still, point belong to the line. So, and when you may think about further a group of transformation which even may not preserve the shape of lines. So a line may go to some curve, but still if you say what points belong to that new image, so there is still something invariant, something which preserved by that bigger group of transformation. Of course, the different group have different properties, and then you may ask what, how to derive a particular geometry if you are starting from a given group. Again, what happened historically? Historically, when Erlangen program was formulated, a lot of different geometries was already found, and Felix Klein actually not presenting much new results. He rather proposed a classification of a known geometries. So you now put what is affine, what is projective, what is Euclidean geometry, just according to corresponding group of symmetries. And then it was believed for a long time that Erlangen approach is good only for that. It's a classification tool. It's not a tool to derive new result, new theorems. And there is a reason, because somehow that proposition came much ahead of its time, because in 19th century, the group theory was not developed much. In particular, representations of group, which we will discuss in this course, was not developed much. And then it's turned out what, based on the knowledge of the group, homogeneous spaces representation, which was obtained in 19th century, you simply cannot find new results out of that proposition. But situation changed now. So in 20th century, huge progress was made in the classification of representations for the group, and structural theory of the group was described in many important cases. And we are now in the position when Erlangen program may be used for the derivation of new theorem and new results. And this is what will be covered particularly in our first part of the course. We will see how much how to obtain new result, new theorem, based on that ideas of Felix Klein. And you will see what even for very classical objects, such like circles, parabolas, and hyperbolas, this is something which is studied by mathematicians for more than 2,000 years already. And you believe for this period of time, people discover almost everything what is ever possible to find about these objects. Nevertheless, using the Erlangen approach and our knowledge of group theory at this point, we still able to find new theorem, and some of them is rather interesting, or at least look interesting to me. Also, I would like to highlight a certain connection between various ideas related to geometry. If you again look in the history on mathematics, you will find out what from very early day mathematics was treated in two separate parts. Was a geometry, something which was described by pictures and some drawing and maybe again some continuity. And it was an algebra when we have calculations similar to that factorization which we have discussed. And they was somehow separated areas. So we have separately geometry, we have separate algebra, and there are no much connection between them. And it was a very great proposition, discovery, so invention, by René Descartes in 1637, which suggests a reduction of geometrical problems to algebraic one. So again, if you will come to classical Euclidean geometry and try to find out how synthetic proofs are done in Euclidean geometry, so you will typically notice what if you have, say, a certain theorem about the triangle and you want to prove something, for example, what is the property of inscribed circle, when you need to add some additional lines, you may look on certain special new points. So you need to be creative. So it's somehow far from triviality how you are working in Euclidean geometry setup. It's certain art. While the algebraic transformation, it's more technology. Once you know the basic algebraic rule, you may do it mechanically, or even in nowadays, you can ask computer to do it for you. There are computer algebra system with symbolic calculations, and they can do some reduction factorization for you, and they may be even more efficient than us in doing such transformation. While that geometrical construction still, this is something which very difficult to teach computer, so it require really like artificial intelligence to understand geometry in synthetic way. And so René Descartes, as you know, was the first who proposed to introduce coordinate system. And then on the plane, you may think about a point being just a collection of two coordinates, A, B. And then certain relation between geometrical objects can be reduced to algebraic relation between numbers. And a geometrical problem, instead of being solving in synthetic way, can be now treated algebraically. And so it was really a huge step. Well, from philosophical point of view, it was a great achievement also, because it was unifying to different branches of mathematics. And when it show what, in fact, mathematics as unified subject, it's very really important observation, and we always meet that type of challenges in the history of mathematics. So nowadays, again, you have a lot of branches of mathematics. There are differential equations, there are function theory, there are topology, there are algebraic stuff like algebraic topology, algebraic varieties, other fields. So we have a lot of branches, and a lot of mathematicians may spend entire life working in when some particular small area. And we may, again, forget what mathematics is really connected. So there are a lot of different interesting links between various areas. And however, they look remote one from another, what were maybe separated as disjoint. Nevertheless, that lesson which we learned from Cartesian idea, the first great idea of this type, what really mathematics can be unified, and there is certain common language. When Cartesian idea was to reduce geometry to certain algebra, to solving a system of equations, instead of doing the pictures and constructions with compass and ruler. When Galois, quite almost 200 years later, find the astonishing result that solvability of algebraic equation is closely related to certain group. So, and that it was it particularly had a consequence what algebraic equation, a generic algebraic equation of order higher than 4 cannot be solved in radicals using roots. Actually, if you will combine these two ideas together, geometry reduced to equation, equation connected to the group, you already hear with the Erlangen program. So geometry is connected to certain groups. So that is really what was contributed to by Felix Klein. And we also need to say what a huge influence on Felix Klein was given by Sophus Lie, a Swedish mathematician who also contributed or created that new area of the group theory, which we know as Lie group. Now, this is the group which not only have certain algebraic structure, as a typically group has, but together with this algebraic structure, we have some topology, some continuity. So you are not only able to multiply elements of the group, you also may decide which element of the group are close to another. And that combination of two type of structures in mathematics is very fruitful. So if you will look around, you will see what many interesting areas of mathematics are exactly of this type when we have different structures coming from different areas, but they somehow work together. For example, what is functional analysis? You just take vector algebra, you add vectors, you multiply vectors, but you add some topology to these vector spaces, and then topological vector space, this is the field of analysis, which is very rich and powerful tool. And again, if you look on modern subjects, it's typically two words describing subject, like differential topology, algebraic variety. So something which you have two structures coming together. And continuous groups of Lie is exactly example of that fruitful idea, what we need to combine something. So again, as I told you, by the time when Erlangen program was proposed, knowledge of group theory and representation for a group was not so advanced, and you really cannot derive new theorems out of that idea, new geometrical theorems. But what happened later, what this idea of invariance, what geometry studying something which is invariant under group transformation, was adopted by physicists. So if we come back to that non-Euclidean geometry, and we may ask what is the meaning of that strange geometry, how it's related to universe, it turned out what space-time geometry is exactly that additional or unusual type of geometry, and we usually formulate special relativity in the way which very similar to Erlangen program. We are saying what physical law, all physical law, shall be invariant if we are moving from one observable to another observable. But this transformation of coordinate system or reference point when we come from one observable to another is actually a kind of group transformation. And that group is known as Lorentz transformation, transformation of space-time, when we have certain description coming in from mathematical structure of this group to physical theory. And SL2R will provide a particular simple example or simplified example. So we will see that relativity will come very often in our discussion. Space-time structure in the simplified case where we have just one direction for space and one direction for time. So again, if you may think about the real world, you would say what space is three-dimensional, and but practically we just need to have a certain relation between space coordinate and time coordinates, which already present and which can be already illustrated in this simplified picture, where we have just one particular space direction. So it's important to have just space, one space and one time direction to make an example. So that ideas of Erlangen program, although maybe not all physicists will know that mathematical background, but they now really very important and became cornerstone for modern physical theories. So whenever you formulate new physical theory or you study existing physical theory, you should make it in invariant way. So again, one of the key principles of physics, what if you do experiment here in India, and when other scientists and other physicists need to be able to verify your experiment in another city, say China, Russia, or United Kingdom. So that means a transformation of reference points from here to where, so you need to formulate certain physical law which is invariant under such transformation. And so in physics, that ideas of Felix Klein are very useful and popular, and they probably became now more important even to mathematics. And furthermore, that ideas of the invariance and importance of the group shall be used not only to the geometry. Actually, again, we already mentioned it, mathematics is unified. It shall not be broken into separate subjects. There are a lot of links, and usually that links very helpful and useful when you are studying mathematics. So that ideas of Felix Klein can be used not only in geometry and can be used in other areas. And what we will do in our course, we will also demonstrate how ideas of Felix Klein can be used in the analytic function theory and how they can be used in operator theory. So, and this is what I called Erlangen program at large. So not only be restricted to the geometry, but trying to apply it to various fields of mathematics. And probably there is no limit where you can apply Erlangen program and where is where you cannot apply. Probably to a certain extent, Erlangen program is useful and applicable to almost any field of mathematics. So just depending what is suitable. So it, because it's so general, somehow it's so philosophical. So for this reason, it's applicable to very wide range of areas. So now just a couple of words how our course is structured. So we will illustrate Erlangen approach, so that ideas, on one particular example. We will take one group, SL2R, which is somehow relatively simple in the sense what it's probably minimal interesting example which you can consider. But it's already highly non-trivial. So there are a lot of interesting consequences which we will obtain here. And to derive geometry, derive analytical function, derive certain functional calculus from SL2R, of course, we need to make certain study of SL2R itself. So we will learn how it can be decomposed into smaller subgroups, what are homogeneous spaces and other things. Again, SL2R is particular important example of a Lie group. So it may be what you had some knowledge of Lie groups already, then it's fine. So you may just see how that theory of Lie groups is applicable to that particular example. Or you may not have such knowledge of general Lie groups. Then it's again not a big problem, because for SL2R we will not make will not study s- kind of general theory. Rather, at every time, instead of some general result, general theorem about Lie group, we can do simply a particular calculation. So because group is relatively simple, it's small, so instead of using some high-end theory of Lie groups, we just can do some calculation with 2 × 2 matrices, and so that make things simpler and accessible, even if you are not familiar with Lie groups at all. Once SL2R more or less understood, we will move to the geometry, and we will see how in details, it's something which relatively well elaborated, the corresponding geometry which appears from SL2R group, and you will see the variety of different theorems and results which can be obtained in this way. And afterward, we will try to have illustration what Erlangen program at large mean. We apply the same ideas which we use for geometry in order to construct analytical functions based on the symmetries of SL2R. And when we will build analytical functional theory, we will apply that knowledge for certain functional calculus or the area which may be treated as non-commutative geometry. When we will move towards the end of our course, it will be less and less results known and more possibility for a younger researcher to participate. So watch out and use your opportunity, your chance to discover new results. So it's still a huge field of where to investigate. So you mean 10 minutes? You just give me a sign, okay? So, okay, probably it was enough philosophy, enough history. So let's go to mathematics itself. So let's look on that object. What is SL2R? Really, SL2R may be defined very simply. You take 2 × 2 matrices with real entries, and you just put one condition, what determinant of this matrix is equal to 1. So what is, and just again maybe give you a brief description, remind the definition, what group is. So group is an object which has certain multiplication, so on it, which is an associative binary operation. So and we have certain special object which is known as identity in the group, and property is what the product of identity with any other element of the group is that element again. And second, what for any element of our group, we have operation of taking inverse, which has the property what a product of element of the group is producing that identity element. So it's just a reminder of basic definition. So when we have this group of 2 × 2 matrices, so that operation which we are discussing is the product of matrices. So if you have two such matrices, so where a result of multiplication is again 2 × 2 matrix, where you do multiplication in usual way. So first element will be A prime plus B C prime, and respective elements you can calculate yourself. So this is what we are known from typically course of linear algebra. We also know the property what determinant of a product of two matrices will be determinant of A times determinant of B. So if determinant of a matrix equal to 1, then it's told you what two such matrices will be multiplied again to a matrix with determinant equal to 1. And it's easier to calculate what is identity element here. It's simply identity matrix. So if you multiply again, as you know from linear algebra, that to any matrix, you get that matrix back. And then it's again from linear algebra, it's known what shall be inverse for that matrix. So using property what determinant is equal to 1, we in fact find the inverse here in that particular form. So multiplying this matrix to the matrix G, you get the identity matrix. So that condition determinant equal to 1 is really necessary for invertibility. So again, as we know from linear algebra, existence of inverse is related with determinant shall be non-zero. And in particular, for purposes which we are studying here, that would be the crucial, what we will consider in our course. Again, what also useful to know, what SL2R is related to some other groups, which is we will meet and discuss during that course. So SL2R is really isomorphic to a group SU. I think it should be 1, 1 here. So it's misprint in this place. So this is the group of matrices. If this matrix has real entries, so as U11 has complex entries, but a bit more symmetries here. And we will discuss particular form of that group later on in our course. It will be related to Kelly transform from the upper half plane to the unit disk when we meet that group. And from the point of view of physical application, it worth to notice that relation, what SL to R will be the group of the relativity for one-dimensional space plus one-dimensional time, so which I already mentioned. So that also will be discussed on several occasions in our course, so how it's related to SL to R. So that is a group. Again, if you are familiar with the Lie group theory, so it's worth to mention what this is a simplest example of so-called semi-simple Lie group. Again, it's again just for people who are in that theory. We will not use some general theorems, but if you will be going to study general theory of semi-simple Lie group, SL to R is the simplest example, and somehow all characteristic or important properties related to that theory would be related or will be already illustrated on SL to R course. When Lie group, besides of that algebraic structure which is given in definition, so Lie group is a continuous group or smooth group. It is smooth manifold. So in addition to algebraic structure, we have here the notion of topology. So we may just consider elements A, B, C, D to be close to other elements in this group. If that elements are close in usual topology, so in topology which is coordinate-wise, so you slightly change some coordinates in this matrix, you obtain a matrix which is not far from given one. And we will speak a little bit more on particular consequences of existence of such smooth manifold structure. Probably, again, it will be not much necessary for our course, but let's geometrically try to understand how that manifold look like. For example, what will be its dimensionality? We have four entries, real entries, so it's four parameters, and one condition, determinant equal to one, so dimensionality of that group will be four minus one condition, it's three-dimensional. And then the geometrically SL to R group as collection of certain points with topology can be thought as the full torus. So you just take such full torus, it's solid one, not only surface two-dimensional, it's a complete three-dimensional torus, which is as topologically represent SL to R. As you can see, it is connected, so means what from one point you always can go by continuous path, but it's not simply connected. So if you make a cut, say here, across the group, it will not fall into two disjoint parts, it still remain connected. So that is saying what it's connected, but not simply connected. So that is basic information about SL to R. Let's look further on particular relation to the Lie group structure. Important thing on the Lie group, what you can use smoothness of this group or structure as manifold to you apply certain tool from mathematical analysis. Things like derivatives, things like limits, they are possible on Lie groups. So again, what is Lie group? So maybe simple illustration. So it's a manifold. Manifold means locally it's like Euclidean space. So in our case it's three-dimensional, so it's three-dimensional. But for illustrational purposes, I will draw the two-dimensional manifold. So locally we have that manifold structure. It's look like the Euclidean space. Then we have identity element. And we may consider a tangent space to that manifold at the identity. So we have tangent, so say surface to be a ball, and then there is some flat tangent space to that surface. When you are working with Lie groups, it's very useful to have an infinitesimal object which describes this Lie group that is known as Lie algebra. What is this infinitesimal object? So consider the semigroup, one parameter semigroup on our Lie group. So this is a map from real line to G, to the group G, which is a group homomorphism. So that means GT plus S. So if you add real numbers as parameter, will be the same as product of two elements in our group. Again, what I probably forget to tell at the beginning, you shall already know from linear algebra that multiplication of matrices is not commutative. If you multiply two same matrices in opposite direction, you get a different result in general. So our group is not commutative, so that makes this group interesting and non-trivial. But here we have only one-dimensional subgroup, so one-dimensional subgroup is always commutative. It's image of commutative group of reals under addition into our group. And it's easy to find some examples of one-dimensional subgroups in SL2R. That is example of matrices of this type, for example. So if you have cosine t, sine t, minus sine t, cosine t, and you multiply by the same matrix with a parameter s, so cosine s, sine s, minus sine s, cosine s, then for such a product, again doing usual multiplication, you get cosine t times cosine s minus sine t sine s and some other elements. But as you know from trigonometry, this is exactly cosine of t plus s. Right, and for other element, it will be the same trigonometric rules which we will obtain. So this is exactly example of such homomorphism. This is not some example. This is very important example which we continuously meet in our course. So this is first time introduction to that particular subgroup. And then, if you have such homomorphism of reals into our group, you may use analysis calculus to calculate the derivative. And when group law here, consider it step by step. So we differentiate with one parameter subgroup with respect to parameter t. So according to definition, what is derivative? It's the limit of fraction increment of function by increment of argument. So because this is a group homomorphism, gt plus s is the product of gt times gs. So gt is a common factor here. We put it outside of fraction. So what is remain here in the limit under s is independent of t. So at every point t, you have the same limit here. So that limit is of special interest. And that limit will be denoted here by x. And if we are considering that picture with the manifold and tangent space, when one parameter subgroup, by the way, out of that property here, immediately follow g of 0 is always identity on the group, just because you shall have that relation for g of 0. So it shall be the same as identity. So we put it E, this is g of 0 in this place. And here, for this parameter subgroup, derivative at 0 will be a tangent vector. So this is in terms of differential geometry. If you had a chance to study a course on differential geometry, this is a definition of tangent vector to a manifold. So it's derivative of such one parameter subgroup of a curve on your manifold. So sorry, my air still blocked after the flight. Can you repeat it loudly?
Derivative of g exists always.
Does that mean
the limit exists always?
Well, yes. This is a good question. Of course, whenever you have a limit, question is it exists or not. So this is the right question. So for smooth group, so this is how we define Lie group is a smooth group, and smooth means that limit exists, so that derivation is possible. So that is there are a certain again high theory behind it. What you need to request. And there is a theorem of Pantryagin, what you actually can start from just topological group and under certain reasonable assumption, having a topology is sufficient to produce a smoothness. So, but we don't need it for our particular case. So it's it's just a simple thing. And let's use that general formula for derivation of one parameter subgroup for derivate that subgroup which we already introduced here. And in fact, that derivation, when you have that derivative of gt with respect to t, it's very straightforward. You may, again, being an advantage to work with that particular example, what you can do, calculate everything by hand without high theory. So just out of usual matrix theory, so if you put that limit when s tends to zero, and when you put here cosine t, sine t minus sine t, cosine t plus s, t plus s, minus cosine t, sine t, sine t, cosine t, divided by s. When you do some algebra, you will see what you are simply differentiate each term. So this is linear algebra. You add or subtract two matrices. It's term by term. So when you put a limit term by term, so you get the answer what it will be derivative of cosine, which is sine. Yeah, sine. Yeah. For sine derivative or for cosine, it's minus sine, right? It's minus sine, cosine, t, then minus cosine t, sine t. And we, if we want to calculate what is x, which we are considering here in front of t, we need to make substitution t is equal to 0. And when you make that substitution here, you get a matrix 0, 1, minus 1, 0. Now, this is how to pass from the one-parameter continuous subgroup to tangent vector here to derivative, but we may go in the opposite direction. So really, what the equation tell us, what derivative of t is really, if you look on that calculation which we done, certain x time that subgroup itself. This is a first order differential equation, a rather simple one, and you know a solution. And the solution for such an equation, if written formally, if you forget at the moment what you are speaking with the group, you just think about a function of some real values, then solution will be, of course, gt be e to the power t times x, right? Well, maybe with a constant c. So I will not put it so in general. So and then it's, of course, clearly will be a subgroup because it will be e t plus s x, which is e t x e s x. So this is the way how to build that solution of differential equation in the simple case. If it's real valued, but if it's not real valued, if we have value in the group, in our case, it's still possible to make solution as that exponent, but exponent need to be understood in very simple way as the Taylor series. So we have that formula here, and we just operate in very straightforward way. So coming back to our previous calculation, if you will have, say, that matrix and you would like to calculate what will be exponent of this matrix times t, so it will be 0 t minus t 0. And in term of Taylor expansion for the exponent, it will be the sum n times 0, infinity, so you have that matrices shall be raised to the power n and divided by n factorial. Then, again, linear algebra tell you, you try to multiply matrices, but you will very quickly to see what if you multiply this matrix to itself, just a square of it, it will be minus identity matrix. So essentially, again, if you will think, it's a way to represent a relation I squared is equal to minus 1. So that matrix really represents such a number, imaginary number. And so when clearly what will be the cube, because you have identity here, and what will be the fourth power, and so on, so on. So it's easy to see what 0, 1, minus 1, 0, to the power 2n, it will be just minus 1 to power n times identity matrix, right? And 0, 1, minus 1, 0, to the power 2n plus 1, will be minus 1 to power n, and here matrix 0, 1, minus 1, 0. So just by induction, it's easy to prove that powers of matrices. When you substitute it into that relation, and you indeed see what adding corresponding terms, you will see what you have even terms appear on the diagonal, you will get cosine t, sine t, minus sine t, cosine t. That matrix can be rebuilt back by that exponent. So again, there is some big theory. So that what we did here for SL2I explicitly by explicit calculation. So that can be done also in general for general Lie groups, but we don't need that for our course. So but just give you an idea how it's work for that particular case. So probably it's time to finish this particular lecture, and we will something to continue next time.